The president wanted to take another trip to North Africa, and he wanted to sail. He did not want to fly. He had flown, when my father was naval aide, he had flown with him to Casablanca, to those conferences, and the president didn't like it much, but he did it. So this time, going back, he was a little bit older and a little bit more tired probably, and he thought, well, I'm going and I want to go on Iowa. And he was taking all kinds of people with him, all the joint chiefs, and they had to make room for them. They were going to build a bathtub for the president, and everything had to be so secret. And my father hated secrets. He said, if two people know something, maybe you can keep it a secret, but when three people know it, you can't. But they did very well.
A lot of stuff we learned by rumor, scuttlebutt, you know. But in the case of the president, they told us that we were going to have the president aboard. I think they tightened security because they didn't want us going ashore and telling anybody, you know.
He would not leave on a Friday. It was a superstition of the president not to sail on a Friday, being a young sailor himself. So they brought the president out by yacht to the ship.
And they brought him aboard in a bosun's chair. And there's a chief petty officer waiting with a wheelchair to put the president in the chair. The president could not walk.
And they sailed after midnight. They were well into the Atlantic, making some kind of a target practice. And they had, I think, four either light cruisers or destroyers or something escorting the Iowa.
There was an incident about a torpedo that got lost in the...
Well, for some reason, one real one was in the pin, and it got loose, and it was heading right for Iowa. And William D. Porter said, "Lion, lion, fish headed your way. This is not a drill. It is the real thing." Well, everybody went haywire. So they are backing and filling and pulling the end of the thing around and of the ship around and so forth. And there was a loud bang.
And it blew up just off of our bow. It was one of our ships misfired. I think it was a destroyer. And the ship took the shock. Well, the first thing he wanted to know was the president all right, you know. And he was fine, and he spoke to us. He was standing up on the foredeck. We didn't see him in a wheelchair. Of course, he had the rails. Made a little speech and said everything was fine and thanked us.
Admiral King said, "I am relieving the captain of the Porter of his command." The president, to his credit, intervened and said, "Oh, Ernie, it was just a mistake." Now, this is stuff that my father has written down in his memoirs, so I'm just repeating it. But, you know, that was pretty nice of the president not to get all, you know, upset about this whole thing. He just, you know, it was nothing to him. He's kind of an amazing guy. And on they went, and they got to where they were going.
And he went to Tehran. They had the talks there.
With Churchill and Stalin and heads of countries and so forth.
Meantime, the German bombers were detected coming after us. We were ordered to leave the area, and we were supposed to be a ship whose potential was not really ascertained by the enemy yet. How fast we were, what our ranges were, and so on. So as we passed through the Straits of Gibraltar, Spain turned their huge lights on us, and we swung the 16s around like this, and they were ordered to douse those lights or we would destroy them, you know. So they did douse them. We brought him back, and he gave a speech and told us that he was grateful to us and we'd done a wonderful job and all that. I knew there'd been rumors about his health, and when I was looking at him, I realized that he was ashen gray. After we left the president, we went to Panama Canal, and we went to the Pacific. Well, they had all kinds of plans for us out there, you know.